So, recommender systems. So the goal of this last presentation is to explain recommendations and different algorithms for making recommendations, and also to give you some real-world examples of data engineering within an organization. So let's talk about recommenders. Personalization. So what is the motivation? Assume you're on a website like Spotify, YouTube or Netflix, or maybe interested in finding some books. Then you're not going to like all of the overall most popular songs, movies or books. Some songs might be very popular, but not necessarily popular, not necessarily preferred by you. The same is true if you go to some e-commerce sites, then you're also not going to buy only the most popular or recent products. If you go to a news website, you're not only interested in the latest news, and you're also not going to necessarily like the newest post on social media. And also to consider another domain. And maybe the optimal medical treatment for you is different than other people within a certain group that you belong to with the same symptoms. So that's maybe another type of recommendation. So classically, we would use clustering-based or statistical methods, and they assume the same properties for a group of users. So maybe you would divide all your users into groups like young people, and then you would recommend computer games to young people, and another group might be old people, and you would recommend chess, like a new chess board game or something that they can buy. But obviously that's not ideal. Some old people are also into computer games. Some young people also like chess, so that's suboptimal. Also, within medicine, traditionally you divide you divide people into different groups, and so maybe all people that are kind of young with symptom A get a certain treatment X1, and old people with the same symptom A but are slightly older get treatment X2. So that's how medicine works. You divide people into different groups and assign a treatment to each group based on some statistical properties. But that's different from personalization. So in personalization, we assume each user is unique, and the goal is to rank the most relevant or interesting items for each user. So it could be and not the overall most popular songs, but based on your past preferences, on your history of liked songs and so on, that you have a playlist with all songs from artists you liked before, genres you liked, and so on. And so it's more also more of a paradigm, I would say. In this context, often in all these big internet sites, there's a huge amount of information. There are millions of items. And the goal of personalization is also to provide some personalized support in sifting through that large amount of data. So that's in short what personalization is about. If we look at the problem for formulation, we have some characteristics for each data set where you might apply recommendation algorithms. So this is a kind of abstract representation, and it applies for many different domains, including news, media, or e-commerce. We have a set of users, U1 until UN. We have a set of items, E1 to EM. And the items can be it can be movies, songs, products, news articles, social media posts, even medical treatments. Then we have a set of actions. So usually we only consider one kind of action, like page views, But in the real world, we have many different actions. It can be a page view, it can be a like, it can be a rating score, also maybe a product that you bought or a product that you add to your cart, things like that. And then we have metadata about each item and user. It can be the title or category of an item. For users, it depends on the application. Sometimes there's no information available about users. Sometimes you have their history only, and sometimes you have some metadata, like the location of a user, things like that. And then you have finally a history of past events. So this is a large collection of tuples, and each tuple contains the ID of the user, the ID of the item, then some action, was it a click by that user on a certain item or a like, and then a time point. And so that's something we record, and that's what it is stored in our data sets. So sometimes we ignore the timestamps in the history and just present the full history using a user item matrix. And that's shown here on the right. And so each row is a user and each column is a certain item. And like here, I'm not sure what the first one is, maybe some holiday cards and then a book, a TV and a PlayStation controller. And then for each user, you can have, in this case, explicit feedback. So that's a 5-star ranking or rating, sorry, 5-star rating. And so the first user really likes the postcards and only gives a 1 out of 5. So that's rather a bad rating to the TV and so on. And so we can have explicit feedback. So that's really like ratings, that you get on different product pages. We call that explicit feedback because it's explicitly about the quality of the item. But often we also have implicit feedback. So this can just be a view. You just go to that web page of that article, and then that's a page view. And then the matrix changes, and it becomes a binary matrix. So either you have seen an item or you haven't. And obviously the goal is to find out which other items a user is interested in. So like for the first user, he might or might not like the book or the PlayStation or the joystick. So that's something we want to predict. What else the user is interested in the future? What is he most likely to click on? So what are the goals of a recommender systems? So I think the most important one is to predict the confidence of the next action for each user. So I have visited a lot of science fiction movies in the past in Netflix. So if there's a new science fiction movies available, that would be a good recommendation for me. So for everyone, it's personalized, and you want to predict that next view or that next buy for each user. So the way you do it is you create a selection of all items. It can be all items that are available, and then you rank them. So you sort them, and you want to sort them on confidence. So the confidence is for each user. You have the confidence of user X and item Y. And so you want to compute the highest confidence or likelihood that the user is going to engage on some item. And then given that function, given that confidence, we just rank all items using that. And then can be different for different types of actions. So if you just look at views, then it's the confidence of the items with the largest likelihood that you're going to view next. So some more example, which book is most likely to be clicked next for each user, or which book is likely to be bought by a user. So these are different goals. And so in this case, that would be two different confidence functions. So what are other goals? Well, yeah, maximize purchases and attributed revenue. So mainly commercial, mainly a commercial goal. Attributed revenue, that means that you get recommended an item in an e-commerce setting then, and then you click on it and then you buy it. So that's a revenue, a purchase, which can be directly attributed to the recommended item. Also, a second goal is to have just high engagement and also improve user experience in general by providing good suggestions of items given a large catalog and so on. And obviously there, so for high engagements and improve user experience, actually you want also the user to click more on your e-commerce site, for instance, or click more on your social media or news sites. And there, often you see a growth in indirect revenue. So maybe the user is not going to buy something you suggested, but because you show a lot of more interesting items to the user, he will stay longer, or he or she will stay longer on the website, and you have some you have a higher likelihood that you will buy something else. So that's a more increase in indirect revenue. Obviously, there are also some important problems these days. And if you read the newspapers or some interesting Netflix documentaries, there's a lot of problems also with recommenders. So diversification is one in goal, which has become very important in the last couple of years for research. And a lot of research is being done now on diversification. So their goal is to make, it's not only to make recommendations that you are most likely to click, but also to explore other articles. So you also want to suggest novel items. Like for me, I always watch science fiction movies. So maybe the best guess from a recommender based on my past history is to recommend new science fiction movies, but you could also show a new drama movie with very good reviews in general and suggest that. So that's important. Also, given social media content like YouTube or Facebook, we have the problem with of the filter bubble. So maybe in the past I clicked on a lot of right-winged or extremely right-winged or extremely left-winged news, whatever, and then I get suggested only other articles which are extreme in some case. That's very dangerous. So there, the idea of personalization is not that good. It has a lot of issues, and that's something also in the future that maybe different companies are going to change to prevent that kind of unwanted behavior, given that you have extreme or harmful content like you have on YouTube and so on. So that's one important goal. Another one is also to increase coverage and limit the popularity bias. So in general, if you look at recommender system, you often observe a Matthew effect. So Matthew, it's from the Bible originally, or the Matthäus effect. So it's the rich get richer and the poor get poorer. So what you often have is like a couple of songs, and maybe the top 100 songs are each listened to billions and millions of time on Spotify, and then it decreases, and then you have a long tail of maybe millions of artists who are only, yeah, where the songs are only played once or a handful of times. And we see that effect in almost all data sets. Also for products, some games, computer games are really popular, but then you have many more games, maybe hundreds of computer games more, but they're only bought and liked by a handful of people compared to these top games. And so that could also be a goal of recommenders, to increase the coverage, to recommend more less, to recommend less popular items instead of only suggesting the most popular ones. So these are some goals. And then we have our four main strategies, strategies for personalization and for creating algorithms. And so the first type of strategy is in essence not personalized. So not personalized suggestions are still important. Often, like in news, if you have a news site, maybe the you just rank news article on recency. So that's a good baseline. You can just have the most recent items on top, or you can also have the most popular items on top, or you can also sort items on decreasing or increasing price, and so on. And you can have some interesting combination like trending items. So trending is a combination of recency and popularity. So for instance, we can show the movies and the most viewed movies using a 5-day window, and make a suggestion list ranked on this statistic. I think if you go to Netflix, there's always a trending box on top. So that's the first strategy, not personalized. I'm not going to talk about that much more, so since these algorithms are rather trivial to implement. And then the second category is content-based, and in content-based, we make recommendations using the available metadata. So we basically rank items that are similar using the metadata. And so, for instance, if you click on a Samsung Smart TV, some specific model, you click on that, and then you get suggestions from other Smart TVs and from other Smart TVs where the brand is also Samsung. So that would be a typical content-based recommendation. Then we have collaborative filtering-based techniques, and there we actually, collaborative, another word might be social, it might be social filtering-based techniques, and here you rank items based on preferences, based on a model learned on the history of all users. So you really look at what do all users have watched or clicked in the past, and then you learn a model out of that using machine learning and use that to make predictions for each users. For instance, what you might have on Netflix or something is a suggestion from other users who have viewed Star Wars: A New Hope, also watched The Mandalorian. So that might be a suggestion, and here you would observe from your data that of the billions of users you have on Netflix, rather millions, and a lot of those users that have watched Star Wars in the past also watched The Mandalorian. And maybe you have watched Star Wars in the past, and then because of that association, learned on the complete history of all users, you will be suggested The Mandalorian. And then a final category is more using multi-arm bandits or in general reinforcement learning. So here we consider the recommender a little bit like an AI agent, and it shows recommendations, and then you get feedback from your users, and then you can update your model, your artificial agent, based on rewards. So, for instance, if the agent has a certain strategy or policy to show in a certain way recommendations, and then you click a lot of that, that's a reward for the model. And then the agent will know, I'm doing a good job. And if you don't click on any recommendations, it might change internally and adapt its model to show more relevant recommendations. Recommendation, something like that. And so for today, to limit the scope a little bit, I'm only going to talk about content-based and collaborative filtering-based techniques. Okay, content-based recommendations. Here's an overview. This screen is from the book by Lopes Pascal et al. from the Recommender Systems Handbook, which was published in 2011. And so it's a large scientific manual. It's about 800 pages. It's very clearly written, so you can definitely have a look at it, but it's a big book. But for content-based recommendations, in general, the idea is to match the attributes of a user profile in which past preferences and interests are stored, with the attributes of a content object. So I gave you the example before where you click on a Samsung Smart TV and then you get suggestions of other products where either the brand is Samsung or the category is Smart TV or both are true. Another example is for news recommendations. For instance, a user might have clicked a lot of articles in the past and most articles were on Hulshout and Heist op den Berg, so regional news. And then you can suggest recent articles based on the regions near Hulshout and Heist op den Berg. So this is also kind of content-based recommender. If you look at the flow or the architecture of such a system, you start with your data. So you have data about your items. It could be the titles of news articles or for products might be other features like brand or category, price, and so on. And you analyze that content, and then you have a kind of structure representation of an item. And so that you could do that using Python and Pandas. And then you can represent your item in a structured way. Given that a certain user has clicked a number of items in the past, given its history, we can have a profile of the user. And we can learn that using machine learning or some simple statistics. For instance, if a user, for content analyzation, we can extract the region for each article, and then maybe the profile of the user is the top three most viewed regions in the past, of all articles he viewed in the past. So that can be the profile. And then given that profile, and given that there are new items, we filter new items that are most similar or near or match the best with the user profile. And finally, the filtering component actually produces a list of recommendations, which are then shown to the user. And then a final step, it's not always done, is to include the feedback. So if the user then clicks on the suggestion, you might use that as a signal to further improve your recommendation algorithm. So that's the general flow. And I'll give one example of a content-based recommendation. And it's a little bit into in-depth the explanation, but don't worry, I think I explained it in a very clear way. So this algorithm is a nearest neighbor based model, and it uses metadata features because it's a content-based algorithm. It uses the metadata. And so for instance, you have a user U1, and that user last viewed item E1, and item E1 has a number of features. So I used here there are N features. It can be the category, the age of the article, several keywords on the article. These are all features. And so the goal is to match that item, E1, and make suggestions of other items, EN. That are the most similar. So each item has N features, and we want to compute items that are the most similar. And so what we can do is compute similar items using cosine similarity. Because similar, it's a human concept. You have to compute that in some way. So one way to do it is using cosine similarity. And here each item, so the metadata features of each item are presented as a binary vector. And then we can compute the cosine similarity as the cosine of these two vectors. And so you, in contrast to high school, where you typically compute cosine in a two-dimensional space, here we compute the cosine in an here in the example, actually, it's an n-dimensional space. And so we have these n features, and we can compute the cosine using that. And it's just a measure of how close these two items are. And I'll give you an example. For instance, we have two items here. They're both Samsung smart TVs. They're both 50 inch, but the type number is different. Yes, and so just by looking at these, you can see they are very similar. And if you go to the final line, you will see the final remark here in the slide, that the final cosine similarity will be 0.75. So pretty high similarity. So if you would click on the first item, then the second item might be a good suggestion because it's very similar. So how what do we do? Well, first we use a technique called one-hot encoding. And one-hot encoding is just a technique to create a set of binary values for each attribute. So you have the brand, you have the category, you have the diagonal and the type of each item in this case. And then you just create a binary vector. So you say, item one, the brand of Samsung is one. It's not of Sony. The brand Sony is zero. Brand Philips is zero. Category phone is zero. Category smart TV is one. And so that's one hot encoding. You just take every possible value for each feature. And if that feature is equal to the value is one, and otherwise it's zero. So if you do that for these two examples, you have this long binary vector, and then here you have the first value is one in the same dimensions for both items. So that might be the brand Samsung, which is one. Then the second value is zero, so that might be brand Sony, which is both zero, which is zero for both items. And so on. So they have both have a smart TV category, that's also one that they share. They both have the same diagonal, so that's also one. And maybe the last two values indicate the type, the type number, which is different. So type equal to Q50T64 might be one for item one and zero for item two. And the other way around for type number Q55T80 in this example. And then we compute the cosine. So given these binary vectors, the cosine is actually just a dot product. Between every pair of items. So in this case, the dot product is three. So that means we have only three attributes, three feature values where both item one and item two have a one, so that's three. And then we normalize this dot product to this dot product by dividing by the unit length of each vector. And so in this case we have four ones, and so if you square one, it's also one. So it's just divided by the square root of four times four. So the result will be 3 divided by square root of 4 times the square root of 4, and the result will be 0.75. So that's how you can compute the cosine, and you can do that for every pair of items. So you can compare our Samsung 15-inch TV with dishwashers or other smart TVs, and if they don't have any feature value in common, then the similarity will be zero. And if they have all values, if all values are in common, similarity will be one. So using this technique, we can compute the content-based similarity between each pair of items. And this has a complexity. If you remember the third week or the second week, I forgot. This has an n squared complexity. because you have to compare each item with all other items, so that's n squared, and here n is equal to the number of items, yeah, e. So that's not a fantastic complexity, however, the number of items is usually limited. So usually there are much less items than there are users. So it's still feasible. Also, we can never leverage sparse optimization. For instance, if two items do not share a single feature, then the cosine similarity will be zero, and you don't even have to compute it. So we can program that in a more efficient way. And also, we can pre-compute these similarities offline using batch processing. So even if you have millions of items, this can take a while, but we can do it offline. And if it then takes an hour or half an hour in many applications, that's not a problem. And then so for final recommendations, we can then return the top k set of items the most similar to the active item. So if you click on some news article, I don't know, a COVID outbreak in a school in Antwerp, then we can suggest similar articles, so maybe also on COVID-19, or maybe also in the same region, Antwerp, or both about COVID-19 in Antwerp and in a school, then they have the highest similarity, and you can suggest items based on that. Also for a product, you would suggest products with the same brand, category, price, and so on, or a high overlap between the currently viewed products and the products available in the catalog. So that's one type of system. Here is a data pipeline. So this is an example of how you would implement it or deploy it within an organization. So you could use some kind of cloud vendor infrastructure as a service. Can be AWS or Google Cloud or Microsoft Azure, whatever. And then you go to a website such as Dreamland. Probably you have a load balancer, because if there are many users, one web server won't be enough. And what the web server does is it returns a document in HTML format at the site content. That's how it works. And typically with a load balancer, you would do like a round robin approach where the first user is assigned to web server one, the second user to web server two, and so on. And you would spread out the load evenly on both servers. Then each web server wants to have some kind of recommendation. So maybe the user has clicked on a Lego set and you want to have recommendations similar to that specific Lego set. Then you would do a REST call, use the REST API over HTTP and ask to the content-based recommender system service to get a list of items ranked according to content-wide similarity or something. And so the content-based recommender system just returns a list of interesting items based on the item that you have last clicked. So that would be hosted on a different service. Server. And usually you want to have some low latency here, so it should respond within 200 milliseconds or something like that, and then return this list, and then in the web server can then display it in with nice formatting and so on, and show it to the user. So that's one thing. So how would you do that? Well, we assume we have a relational database where we may have a table about item metadata. And so there you would have an ID for each item, the title of the item, the brand, the category, the price, and so on. That would be stored there. And then for offline model training, you would query the database, you would get a list of all products, and then you can compute your model. So for instance, you can represent each item after transforming brand and category using one-hot encoding, and then compute the similarity between all item pairs, and using that you have your model. So may take some while, so that's why it's offline, may take half an hour or 10 minutes depending on the data size, and you could use that in Python or compute it using something like MapReduce or Spark. And after this training step, so that's repeated every hour or half an hour, depends on the type of applications. For news, it's typically much shorter because there are many new articles every hour. So you might do it offline every 15 minutes. For e-commerce, typically you have few changes in products. So products stay online for a longer time, so you have less requirements to train it. You can train it every day or every 12 hours or something. Actually, a colleague of mine is doing research on optimizing that. So finding out what the optimal schedule is for model training. So once you have done that, you return your model, and that model is used by the online content-based recommender system to make predictions or to make suggestions for items that are most likely to be of interest for each user. And so that online computation has to be fast, but like in the content-based case, it's easy. We can just store for each item the top 10 or 50 or 100 most similar items. We can store that and then just return that list. So that's basically just returning an element from memory, or you could even use database for that. So that's how you could implement it online. Some strength weaknesses of content-based recommenders. So again, this is by I reference here the recommender system handbook by Lopes, Pascal and all et al. What is a strength? They have high transparency, and so it's usually easy to explain why you made the recommendations. And so explanations are important because then the users can trust the set of recommendations more. So you can give a caption like, these are other similar smart TVs, or these are other similar horror movies, or something like that. And then you can show that to the user. Also an advantage or strength is there's no problem of cold start. So for instance, the first time a new item is online, or even the first time your website is online, you don't have any history. Not a single user has clicked on the new item if it's just been released. So if you use other systems, then you cannot, that depend on the history of each item, you cannot compute recommendations. But for content-based, that's not a problem because you have the metadata of the item, and you know the title and the price and so on. So you can just compute your recommendation, even if a single user has not clicked on this item. Another disadvantage, is over-specialization. So that means that you don't recommend a lot of novel items in this way. So that's called over-specialization. And so that means, you're always going to return similar items, content-based. So the chance that you will suggest a more surprising item, like a drama movie for a user who's only been interested in science fiction in the past or something like that, that won't be included. And finally, the last trend is using content-based recommendations. You get good accuracy. Often that's measured using click-through rates. So that means the probability of clicking a shown suggestion, and often we find that we have good accuracy on news websites. So news websites where there typically are many new items, since news articles appear daily, and in that context you have a good accuracy with these content-based systems. Okay. Any more questions about this before I continue with the second category of recommenders? Is it a little bit clear for everyone? Yes, no? Okay, I'll just continue. Okay, ça va. Okay, then let's talk about collaborative filtering based recommendations. So with content based approaches, you use the content or the metadata of items previously viewed by a user. So in contrast with collaborative or social filtering, you rely on the history of and the feedback of the current user, as well as those of all other users in the systems. And so typical examples on websites is other users that liked item X also like item Y, or because you liked X, we recommend Y and Z, and so on. And so these you sometimes see on websites. And so there are three algorithms that I want to discuss briefly, so without going into too much technical detail, which is user-based collaborative filtering, item-based collaborative filtering, and matrix factorization. So let's start with user-based collaborative filtering. So here you have a picture shown on the right, and we have three users. So Anne is on top, Julie in the middle, and then Bob below, the arrows signify the past preferences for each user. So we can see that Anne likes grapes, strawberries, melons, and oranges. Julie likes strawberries, and Bob likes melons and strawberry. And so the question is, what would you recommend to Bob? And so that's a question for you. Now, what would you recommend to Bob, given this figure? Strawberries? Well, actually, Bob has already liked strawberries. So, yeah, grapes and oranges. Yeah, indeed. Grapes and oranges is the correct answer. So the reason is, Bob has similar preferences as Anne, since both Anne and Bob both bought melons and strawberries in the past. So Anne is the most similar one. And because Anne has also liked grapes and oranges in the past, it can be, or these are also good suggestions for Bob. So we would suggest grapes and oranges. So that's how user-based collaborative filtering works. So if you have millions of users, probably, that's the argument, there are a number of users who are similar to you. For instance, I like a lot of sweet candy and potato chips and fish. And then probably there are also some users who like those three types of categories or all have these preferences for similar items. And if my, how would you say it, most similar user has bought something I haven't bought before, then that's a good suggestion. And you don't have to only look at only one similar user. In practice, you use thousands of similar users. So if you have millions of users, you would just not choose base your decision on one, on the most similar user, but on the top 1,000 or 500 or 200 most similar users. And then you get a good idea of what's popular. So that's one technique. And then the other technique is item collaborative filtering. So again, a question is coming for you. So here again, we have Anjali and Bob. Anne likes grapes and melons. Julie also likes grapes and melons. For Bob, we know he likes melons. And what else would you recommend to Bob? So grapes and why, Wouter? Why would you recommend grapes? It's a trending item. Yeah, it's a popular item, you could say that. Overall, so that would be one type of suggestions. But others that like melons also like grapes. I think that's the correct answer from Kobe. So indeed, grapes and melons are both preferred by Anne and Julie. So we would conclude that people who like melons also like grapes. And since Bob liked melons, we would recommend grapes. So That's item-based collaborative filtering. So in essence, we look at each item as a vector of all the likes, all the users who have liked that product. And then we can compare all vectors vertically. So the overall similarity of every item pair, something like that. So that's also a way to compute recommendations. And then the third technique is a little bit more mathematically. So it's matrix factorization. So here is the idea is to learn latent factors representing each user and item. So normally we have our user item matrix. So let me go quickly back to that slide. Ooh, it was all in the beginning. So this is our user item matrix, and actually what we want to predict are the missing cells. So the missing cells indicate the user hasn't clicked or bought that product yet. And so for the first row, we want to predict whether what's the score for a book, what's the score for a PlayStation, and the higher the score or the closer the score is to one, the higher the chance the user might like that. So that's the user item matrix. So with matrix factorization, what you actually do, is decompose that matrix into two matrices. And each has k latent factors. So the user factor matrix, if you have n users, has a dimension on n times k. And the item factor matrix has a dimension of m, so the number of items times k. And so each user is going to be represented by k values. And often k is a small number, like 5 or 10. And so what do these latent factors represent? Well, some property of users. So actually we reduce the dimension, and there might be millions of items, but we're going to represent each user and each item using k numbers. And we do this using a decomposition. So if you have our original matrix A, representing the interaction of each user and item, then we can solve A, which has to be approximately equal to the user factor matrix times the item factor matrix. And we want to minimize the loss. So we want to minimize the loss that the original matrix minus the reconstructed matrix in these two k-dimensional factor matrices, that product, we want to minimize that loss. And also to prevent overfitting, and that means that your matrices exactly fit the data but have poor generalization properties, we want to use some regularization. So you want to maybe have that the total weights in the factor matrices X and Y are also minimized. So that's shown here on the figure in the right. So given these factor matrices, we can make a prediction by just using the product. And the idea is that the latent factor for users may be like a lot of gamers. Might be some latent factor. Latent factor might be shared by all game users that are interested to gaming, or other users might be interested in, I don't know, dollhouses, and that might be represented by a weight in another factor, and so on. So we don't know actually what they mean, but we do know by optimizing the loss that they closely match the original matrix A. And so we can make prediction by just computing the dot product. So it's a little bit more abstract, these techniques, but it also works really nice. So for the computation of item-based collaborative filtering, it's actually the same principle as discussed before with the content-based nearest neighbors, where we use the cosine similarity after one hot encoding the item metadata. The main difference here is that instead of representing each item as a vector of metadata features, each vector is actually represented as users who liked or bought the item. So if you have a million users, each item is represented by a vector that has 1 million, 1 million, one or zero, and a one is a certain user X has liked it, and otherwise it's zero. And then we can compute the item-based similarity between each pair. So again, this has a complexity which is n squared, where n is equal to the number of items. But this is still okay because in practice, the number of items is limited. It's usually much less than the number of users. We can also leverage sparse optimization. For instance, if two items do not share a single feature, in this case, not a single user has liked both items, then the similarity will not be computed. And we can also compute this offline using batch processing. And for recommendation, we would return the top k items, which are most similar to the currently active item. So for instance, if you click on a news article, you will get a list of articles based on users who viewed article X, also viewed Y. And if you would click on a product X, you would get a list of products based on users who viewed or bought product X, also viewed or product Y. So that's what that represents. So if you look at an implementation or deployment of that system, we again have our load balancer and people going to the website. In this case, you need some kind of cookie because you're going to record the history of each user. That requires that they accept cookies. Otherwise, you're not legally allowed to store their history. And then each time the user views a certain product, you store this event. So then you store a user X has clicked on item Y at a certain time. And you store that, for instance, in a relational database. And then in that way, you collect the history of all users. Then for offline model training, you're going to select the user ID and the item ID from the page views table. So that means all the users and all the users that clicked on certain items, you're going to select that. And then you can use that as input for your model training. And so we can compute the cosine similarity between all item pairs based on those histories. And then we have a model like grapes is most similar to what was it? Oranges and strawberries or something. We can compute that which users that like one item also like the other item, and that can be done offline in batch using Python or maybe something like MapReduce if you want to do it in a distributed way. And then you have an online collaborative filtering based recommender system. And so for each user that visits a site, you get the ID of the user, and then using that user ID, you can compute online, based on the model, the best recommendations for that user. And so in the case the user has clicked last on a certain item, you can find the most similar items and suggest those. Also doesn't have to be the last item. Obviously, you could use all items of that use history in the past and get a more accurate prediction using item-to-item similarities. So that's how that works. So to wrap up collaborative filtering, some strengths, they have high transparency also. We can explain a set of recommendations for item and user-based collaborative filtering. And because you like X, we recommend Y type of explanations. It does have an issue with cold starts, unlike content-based techniques, because you cannot compute recommendations if the item has never been clicked before. And so for new items, this is problematic, and then we should use some other technique. Also, diversity and popularity bias are an issue, because if some items are really popular in the data, well, in essence, you're going to learn from that data. You're going to learn the popularity bias, and you're also going to suggest more popular items more. That's also an issue with diversity. And so you need some post-processing to account for this. So we can re-rank the output of one recommender and make it more diverse. For instance, make sure that different categories of items are in the output list, or that news does not only contain, I would say, extreme left or extreme right news, maybe if it's from social media, things like that. And one more strength is that you often have better accuracy than with content-based systems, especially for e-commerce. So for e-commerce, you can expect an increase in attributed or indirect revenue, with people maybe spending more time on the site. And then one final word is that in practice, it's often useful to apply hybrid recommenders. So hybrid recommenders make a prediction based on content-based, using content-based algorithm and collaborative filtering algorithm, and then stack both predictions. And so you can, for instance, a simple example of stacking is just using the sum or the product of both predictions. And so that's one way to combine. You can also combine the strengths of weaknesses of each approach using those hybrid systems. Okay. And then one final word. So some real world lessons learned. So I work at Froomel. So my full-time job is also to improve the recommendations we provide for various customers of Froomel. So these are news websites or e-commerce sites, and they ask us to provide services that generate recommendations. So some real world lessons there. Well, the first thing is DevOps. So it's just a slide. I think I explained it in week two when we talked about Linux and the clouds. But just to repeat what DevOps is, so it's kind of a modern system administrator. And DevOps is actually a combination of development and operations. So operation, that means having your service running night and day for all different customers. And what you do is you configure service using infrastructure as a code. And that means you program how you launch, install, and configure your software on your servers. Often it's combined with agile practices. So you have a kind of plan, do, check, act cycle, like a short loop, where you write some code and then you run tests on your code. Then the code gets integrated into the service, and you compile or you build the service, and then the service is deployed. And so it's a really tight loop where you continuously make small changes to your services. It can be software or hardware changes, and then you update that for your customers immediately. I think the old classical way of doing a project was in software engineering. It's called the waterfall cycle, and there it's more like you make a plan. It takes 2 months to make a plan. You write the software that takes 2 months, and then you release the software that takes 2 months, and then there are a lot of bugs, and then you solve them, and that's more of a slow process. So the idea about these agile practices is to do it quickly and online, but still in an organized way. So that's DevOps. So the design of
Excuse me, Professor.
So I have three slides about that in the real world. And so the first thing, DevOps is hard. So when we're talking about product development, it's more than 50% of resources. So effort, man-hour, work hours goes to DevOps. Ah, Kobe has a question. Yeah, shoot, Kobe.
Yes, can you hear me?
Koba?
Hello?
Ah, no, I can't hear you. So maybe you should put
Can
your
the
mic
others
on,
hear me?
or you should
Oh.
type it in the chat.
Okay.
Ah, you can hear Kobe. Wait. Yeah, say something again, Kobe.
Hello?
Ah, yeah, sorry, I can hear you now. Yeah.
Okay, I have a question about the DevOps cycle of the previous slide.
Okay.
Now,
yeah.
Some of these things are familiar to me, like Git, AWS, and Docker, but could you maybe please explain a bit what the operate and the build part of the cycle means exactly?
Yeah, okay. The operate, then you have to imagine we have a lot of different services, like we have the database service for storing new events. We have a service for making recommendations. We have a service that runs batch computations for training the model, things like that. And all these services, well, they have to be, yeah, you have to do a couple of things. First, you have to reserve hardware. So using AWS or Google Cloud, you have to say, give me a computer for running offline batch processing, give me a computer for running the database, give me a server for the online recommendation service, and so on. So that has to be provided. Also, you have to install software. So that means you have to check out code from GitLab, compile it, run it, and so on to install everything. Also, these services needs to be configured. So you have a lot of options, might be specific to each customer, such as hyperparameters for the different algorithms, remote directories where you can get your data, security keys, and so on. And so all that stuff, reserving hardware, installing software, and so on, you can manage that using Kubernetes, and then you have some things like Chef and Ansible. And actually, you can think about it as like Python code. It's not really Python code always, but it's like code in a certain format, and it describes what you need to install. So like in the Linux session, you installed maybe Python and PostgreSQL and linked with SSH. These kinds of operations, these are managed, written in Chef and Ansible. So we call that infrastructure as a code. And then what was the other question? Yeah, monitoring, planning, coding, and then the build step. The build step, you usually use something as continuous integration, it's called. So that means in the past, when I wrote some software, you have to do a number of steps. You have to compile maybe the code. Like in Python, it's not necessary, but in C++ or Java, it's necessary. Then you have to run some tests to see if your code works, some unit tests, things like that. And then you have to install. And if all tests are okay, then you can install your server, your software on the server. So that's called also a build cycle, and that can also be automated using tools like Sonatype or Gradle. Actually, I don't know Gradle, but I imagine it's similar to Sonatype. Is that a good answer to your question, Koba? Yeah. Okay. You're welcome. And so a lot of these techniques don't have a lot to do with data engineering. They're more like software engineering tools and system administrator tools. But I mention them here again because they are in practice. Because as a data scientist, you can write some code in Python for making recommendations or whatever. But that's only a small part of really having a product in development and a service online 24/7. And then you need more of these types of tools. So it's interesting to mention them. Also, that you just are aware that all also exists. Yeah? Okay. So the design of services is difficult. DevOps is hard. takes more than 50% of resources typically. Why is it so hard? Well, we have many technical requirements. We need high availability, low latency. Security is always important these days. You cannot just, we have sensitive data. We have the history of a lot of users. So we have to be really careful about that. We also need to log everything. So if you have a software running on some server and it does 10 steps and step 7 fails, well, we don't know which step has failed. So it's only when you log everything, when you log all the different steps of your processes, that you can debug them in case something goes wrong. So that's logging. You also need to monitor your hardware. Is my server not going out of CPU, RAM, disk space? Also monitor the communication. Often communication is the bottleneck in a distributed system because they're all sharing data and sending messages between services. So communication can also be the bottleneck. And we have to monitor that. Manage the costs also, because in Amazon and Google Cloud, you can start really expensive machines with a lot of CPUs, and then everything works like a charm. But we also have to make some trades there between the amount of resources you use and the costs. You need to scale down and up instances. For instance, if during the day, probably there's a lot more traffic than in the middle of the night. So maybe you need to use additional hardware to service millions of requests and also handle hardware and software failures. So that's difficult, and that's why the Kubernetes and so on is really important. Also, another problem is everything changes. So hardware changes, software changes, data changes, and also requirement change. So you need to adapt to that. So another slide on this, DevOps is hard. You typically have not one services, but many different services working together. We have a service for doing online recommendations, where we use an existing model to make predictions within a couple of milliseconds. We also have a service for storing events. So new user events are coming in, and using near real-time streaming processing, we have to store those events to learn future models and so on. Then we have to compute models in using batch processing. Then we have fallback systems in case the online recommender fails, or for instance, the user doesn't have any history. We need some kind of fallback system. Then there is also data we need to maintain. So we have data, and we want some data. We want to have some data warehousing queries available. And so we have a data warehouse. We have relational data, maybe storing the metadata of items and users. We have all the events in the history, which are typically big data files with terabytes or at least gigabytes of data. And then we also have dashboards to monitor everything, to see if our recommenders are working good and everything. So many different things. And they're also configured in different ways for different customers and use cases. So that even makes it worse. You have all these services. They're connected to each other. But then you have a lot of options for each service and differences in configuration. So each configuration and each customer might lead to a different problem. And then obviously you have Murphy's Law. If anything can go wrong, it will go wrong. Everything that can go wrong, well, it's the same. So that's always true in a real world setting where you actually have real life users and things go wrong. So and then the final part is also the data processing software, so which is more the topic of this course, is also hard. So you have many specialized services, each with their own technical requirements. Also in general, data is noisy. It comes from the real world, so it contains outliers. It also changes over time, so the distribution changes over time. In general, designing bug-free software that processes This noisy data is also difficult. And also, yeah, you have the complexity of recommender systems, which we saw in this presentation. So that's, again, a topic on its own, which is difficult without all the software and DevOps issues. And then I also wanted to say something about work effort estimation, given a complex system. So we have a complex system, complex software, complex deployment, and so on. And if you then estimate the work, it's often not linear. Yeah? So what I mean, if I have a feature A for my software or service, then I have a feature B and a feature C. And maybe each feature on its own, you could think it's about one day of work. But having all three features together, it might be not 3 days, but more closely to 21 days. So that's an estimate. And what do I do? Well, the first thing you implement, maybe feature A is basic recommendation, feature B is having it secure, and feature C is having it within 200 milliseconds or something. So instead of just taking 3 days, you have to count that if you have like security, you have to do it for all modules. So it's not like 1 day more, it's 1 day per module more or something like that. And also when you plan something, you always assume that everything goes well, but you don't plan for failures. You don't plan for a computer bug, a software bug that might take another week to find out and solve. And so I would use a times three multiplier in any estimates. So it's, even if you're aware that it will take three times more time than you plan it, you should still do it. So that's the time three multiplier. And so using that, I think 21 days would be a more realistic projection. And so for example, for Froomel then, if you have like a demo recommender, something I write in Python, and if you ask me to write a content-based or an item-based collaborative filtering algorithm, it will probably take me 1 day or something. But if you want a recommender service with a REST API that has multiple threads, that writes logs, that works and continues to operate very fast with extreme low latency, then yeah, maybe that's 1 month of work. And then if you would ask me to deploy that service with integration with an existing website, ensure high availability, low latency, security, monitoring, auto-scaling, maybe I would say, yeah, that's another month. But then the thing is, what's the total estimate? So it's not 2 months and 1 day. It will be more like a year or something, using the thing that a complex system is not linear if you start adding features. Okay, so that was my final slide. Any more questions? Otherwise, I propose we take a small break, and then I'll continue with explaining the data engineering projects. Any questions? No? No, okay, then I propose we take a 5-minute break.